You guys all ready? Okay, so we were Team Tango and we ended up coming in second place. My name is Alyssa and I'm joined with my team members today, Alicia, Rose, and Megan. So during the trial simulation, we did not place higher than fourth in all of the periods 1, 2, and 3, and we weren't sure why. Later, we found out that there was a market report on pricing, and we ended up finding that our competitors ended up lowering their prices, and we kept ours the same, so we never had that competitive advantage that the customers were looking for. So we always had that higher price. Originally, we used the prices from the simulation as a guide to set our initial prices. Mutating, even though we later found out was not very helpful to the simulation, we used marketing just not on anything specific. So we later found out that we could base it on the trends for certain regions, so we could market products based on what the customers wanted to buy or didn't want to buy, which was more helpful. And several products were sold out, leading us to, having to replenish our stocks and losing sales. So on the next slide, the strategy, we used a cost leadership, which means we had the lowest cost, or we tried to have the lowest cost. And in the simulation, most competitors did this because price was basically the only differentiator. So we tried to follow this consistently, but sometimes the prices dropped too low and we didn't want to sacrifice any of the profit or the money that we were making or not going to make by selling them. So we often let competitors drop their prices a little bit lower and decide that we didn't want to. We've realized that being fully stocked was very, very important. At the end, we saw that we had a little bit higher stock than Team X, which came in first place, but we realized that, since stock didn't replenish until 3 periods after, we kept a high stock. And marketing wasn't a huge thing in the simulation. It didn't have very much influence, but we did end up marketing to certain regions, products that weren't selling very well. And basically, we learned from our mistakes during the trial period with the marketing and the renewing the stock and things like that, which really helped us to be successful in the real trial simulation. And now I'm going to hand it off to Rose to talk about product pricing.
Thank you, Alyssa. So I was in charge of product pricing analysis in our simulation. So, like Alyssa said, our strategy was to be very competitive in pricing. We tried to stick around the market rate without going too low. I looked at the averages of the different regions and estimated a good number to adjust our prices to. But we still strive to generate a profit on each product. I didn't try to undercut the market price. I tried to stay around the market price to remain competitive without unnecessarily giving up our margin. And I did utilize the same strategy throughout the game. So the justification for why we use this strategy is really the only way for us to compete. The performance of our team greatly improved after monitoring the market prices compared to the trial run. So I definitely saw that it was an effective strategy to follow. And we were unable to compete in other ways, such as unique features of the product or different cost-cutting elements in production and transportation that we might have been able to do in the real world. And in terms of how our price changed, it mostly was on a downward decline throughout the game. As the market declined in price, so did our price as well. And eventually, if this were allowed to continue, the price would only be slightly above cost to make or to receive if the game went on longer, as people would just keep cutting their prices in order to try to stay competitive. And here I have the visualization, an example of one of our products. So I used the 500 milliliter lemon spritz as an example, since it was impractical to show six different graphs. They all showed basically the same general idea, which was that surprisingly, the amount that was bought did not seem to vary very much with when we changed the price. It seemed that the buying of our product was very sporadic, but I still do believe that if we hadn't been adjusting our prices appropriately, like before in our trial run where I was just guessing how to change the prices as opposed to seeing what the market rate was, that we would not have done as well. So even though the correlation is not very apparent in this graph, I still believe that we would not have done as well if we hadn't been monitoring the price. As you can see on this one axis, it shows the price in blue. So this is the price you're selling at, and the quantity sold in terms of boxes sold on the other axis, and then over time. So I think maybe one reason why the correlation is not strongly represented here is because we only know the prices that we were selling at. So everybody else in the game was also changing their prices as the game went on. So that may have resulted in this very sporadic buying, or there may be some third random variable that we were unaware of in terms of the purchases customers make or marketing may have been having an effect. So there's still like a third variable out there we're not sure about, but we still believe that our pricing strategy was overall effective.
All right, so I'll talk a little bit about the marketing analysis that we discovered through the simulation. So our trial run overall demonstrated that marketing didn't really have, had a really limited effect on our product sales. It wasn't a huge influence. We overall began the simulation with having absolutely no funding towards marketing. And then throughout each minute and each day, we would kind of determine what kind of needed marketing and what didn't. We examined the trial historical data after every single round just to kind of see if there was any big differences in the north, south, and west region among different products. We allocated our marketing expenses to overall pretty much underperforming products. Most of the products that we sold that were doing really well actually had no marketing efforts towards them. The variations of preferences amongst regions we definitely did look at. So for example, we found that 500 milliliter lemon spritz sold in higher quantities in the south compared to the north. So we thought to definitely market towards heavily that demographic in that market of the south compared to the north, just to save some expenses. So we adjusted marketing expenses based on the quantities purchased across the various regions. And compared to our competitors, we didn't really invest much in marketing, and overall it was about, we were finished in third. And then here's just a graph explaining more of our marketing expenses. So we targeted the north a lot more heavily. We found that they produced in higher quantities, and there was just more of an opportunity for our product to be sold there compared to regions such as the south and the west. And then overall, we think the marketing kind of reflects the customer behavior that we discovered throughout the simulation. So our competitors, our customers tended to buy when our prices were pretty competitive. So like Rose was saying that, you know, as the competitors were dropping the price, so did we in order to be competitive. So overall, we found that customers wouldn't really buy our product if it was for a much higher price, or even almost the same price. Customers seemed to be attracted to more of a lower price product. We did not allocate significant amounts of money to marketing. We again marketed heavily towards underperforming products. Products that sold best, like I said, were definitely not really marketed heavily at all. In the simulation, there wasn't a specific competitive advantage that we could make. So everyone's product was pretty much the same. So we found that our consumers were extremely influenced by price in order to buy products.
And here's just a visualization of the preferences by region. And as you can see, it's quite apparent that certain regions did buy more than others. And this does correlate with the amount of customers in the region. So for instance, the North had the most amount of customers, so it sold the most. And some regions preferred some products over others. It's not always the same product that sold the least by each region. So there definitely was preferences present in the game. And now Alicia's going to go into her inventory and forecasting strategies.
So I'm going to talk about demand forecasting and inventory analysis. So we always strive to have inventory in stock. We noticed that when the trial run, we were losing out on sales because we didn't have enough inventory. So we ordered approximately like every 5 days. We knew that every 3 days it takes to get the inventory in stock. So we would order after we just got replenished. We wanted to compete with the other company, so we just made sure that we always kept our inventory. We did not lose any sales in the game, so that was why we were pretty successful. And we prepared for our products to be purchased in large quantities, we were noticing how it was selling, and we noticed they were selling very quickly once we got replenished. So we started investing with higher numbers as opposed to just 1,000. Depending on the product and how it was selling, we would do 1,500 or 2,000 to make sure that we had enough in stock based on how it was selling. We followed the trend of how it was selling, and we ordered consistently. So here's a visualization of things that were quantity that was purchased. So over the inventory, it was pretty steady. I mean, we did have a huge spike in the beginning of February, and we think that's when the company really took off selling. We did really well in round one, and I think that kind of set us up for the other two rounds. And then we had a major decrease in the beginning of March, which was when all the prices were pretty low. So there wasn't much selling at that point. We had to change our prices to compete. And then we went back up to steady again. And then we were left with stock at the end of the round three. All right, so successes. We were a cost leader. And strategy allowed us to be in the top two in the rank. We generated the second largest income. We had enough inventory to not have low stock or run out. We adjusted our prices effectively. We adjusted marketing expenses to each product based off how it was selling. We were the second highest in sales, and we were the third highest gross margin. And areas of improvement, we had large inventory costs, and we did end up with too much product at the end of the game. We did have some loss of money there. We could have improved in being able to monitor trends and demands faster and have a more precise pricing strategy.
And some areas of improvement would be the pricing strategy to be more formulaic in nature. It was a bit of an estimate that I was doing just because of the time constraints in the game to try to quickly change our prices before we felt far behind. So they were estimates, they weren't specifically formulaic, but in ideal business world, I would have more than just like 5 minutes to decide on new prices. And we would probably reduce our safety stock if we were to do this simulation again, but we believe that having enough stock really did lead to our success though, since if you don't have any stock, you can't make any sales. So lessons or takeaways, it's very important to assure the warehouse is stocked to meet demand. And also to analyze areas to cut expenses, such as inventory or marketing when appropriate, monitor price of competitors and make an educated guess, since just like in the simulation, in the real world, you're not gonna know exactly what your competitors will do next or their specific pricing strategies. Market underperforming products to attract a target market, try to get people to buy your products that might not have been buying them before. And evaluate the demands and preferences of the market to know when the market is changing and when you need to change appropriately.
Okay, and then this is our dashboard. So we decided to do some different charts here. We did the quantity sold by region, and then we have over here the top products sold by region, so the bigger bubbles are the top products as a put in the different colors are each region. And then at the bottom there, we did a pie chart for our average marketing expense. And it turns out we pretty much spent average about the same in each area, except, you know, the north is a little bit more.
So this is our dashboard. And as you can see, if we click on a specific region, it all switches over. So it is interactive.
So it looks like it is filtered by region, and does it work if you click on specific product? Does it sort that way? Oh, I see. That's great. Wow, so convenient. So it's very easy to navigate and investigate. Great job.
Thank you.